Hello and welcome. You're watching To The Point. Tonight we devote the entire program to understanding the Indo-Pakistan joint statement issued last Friday in Ufa. Is it a significant achievement for Prime Minister Modi, or is that a mistaken Indian viewpoint? And has Pakistan's National Security Advisor Sartaj Aziz unraveled the agreement with his comments earlier today, or was he simply appeasing domestic critics? Over the next 1 hour, those are the key questions we should address as we examine in detail the statement's commitments about tackling terror and the 2611 case in particular, but also its apparent silence about Kashmir. In part two, I shall be joined by some of India's most experienced diplomats and editors for the latest view from New Delhi. But first, to assess how Pakistan views the joint statement, I'm joined by the chairman of the Senate Defense Committee, the Secretary General of the Muslim League and former Information Minister, Mushahid Hussain. Mushahid Hussain, the opposition in Pakistan has criticized the India-Pakistan joint statement issued at Ufa in fairly strong language. Sheri Rehman has called it one-sided. Rehman Malik has said it has badly hurt the feelings of the Pakistani nation. Shireen Mazari says it's appeased India. As chairman of the Senate Defense Committee, how do you respond to those views?
Well, of course, it is the duty of the opposition, whether it is in India or in Pakistan or any other democratic country, to be the watchdog for the government and keep an eye on its foibles and mistakes. But I think in this case, perhaps some of the criticism could be misplaced, because I feel that Pakistan went into this discussion with Mr. Modi, which initially was initiated by Mr. Modi at his behest, on his request. And Pakistan went into it from a position of, I would say, relative strength. And Mr. Modi was the one who was doing the U-turn, because he had unilaterally cancelled talks with Pakistan last year in a huff. And then they were trying to bully or browbeat Pakistan, isolate Pakistan, and then complain and crib about Pakistan, whether it's the United Nations or whether it's China or Russia or the United States. But that all fell on deaf ears, and then I think they realized that they were on the back foot, and Pakistan was becoming an increasingly pivotal player in the region where India is also located.
Okay.
So I think that on the whole, it's a modest step forward, and that's what we expected, that at least rather than talking at each other, we'll be talking to each other, which
okay.
is what has happened.
Let me ask you one more question about the response from Pakistan. Do you have any idea how your Army Chief General Raheel Sharif has responded to the Ufa joint statement, or is that still not known?
I would say that on this issue, whether it's the Khaki or the Mufti, and I always say that as chairman of the Senate Defense Committee, we are the bridge between the Khaki and the Mufti, the civil and the military, as it were, in Pakistan. They are on the same page, because the policy is a national policy and the approach is the one which is deliberated after due consultation
okay.
and consensus within our system.
Let's then focus on the actual details of the Ufa statement, and let's start with the fact that although India's key concern, terror, is mentioned in considerable detail, with both the National Security advisors scheduled to meet to discuss it, Pakistan's key concern, Kashmir, has not been mentioned by name at all. At best, it's consigned to outstanding issues. How do you, as chairman of the Defense Committee, respond to that treatment of Kashmir?
I think that Pakistan should have insisted on the inclusion of the K word in the joint statement. Because, you know, in countries like Pakistan or India, optics are important. And sometimes these perceptions overtake reality. And now I think Sartaj Aziz took 3-4 days, but he has clarified it in today's press conference. But it's very important. You can't have, Mr. Thapar, as you know, you can't have Hamlet without the Prince of Denmark. And in this case, it is we are talking of Kashmir, which is the core issue, the crucial issue, the pivotal issue for peace, security and stability in South Asia.
So you're saying something very important, Mr. Hussain. You're saying that the failure to mention Kashmir specifically was a lapse or a mistake on the part of the Pakistani government.
Yes, I would say so. That given that this joint statement is meant not just for the technocrats or the bureaucrats or the political analysts, but it has a resonance at the popular level among the people of the both countries, and they read every word, and then if something is omitted or something is added, it has a certain weight of its own, and then victory is claimed on either side. And I think also, secondly, we didn't have good media management from our side, because spin doctoring is very important in this case. When you have those discussions, you have spin doctors who do that. I think they had a large entourage of bureaucrats without having too many media persons. Mr. Sharif should have done that.
I want to, at this point, play for you what your High Commissioner in Delhi, Mr. Abdul Basit, said to this very program on the 7th of May. He said that Kashmir was in fact the mother of all issues. And secondly, he went on to say that every other issue, specifically terror, was subordinate to Kashmir. Its roots, its genesis and origin lay in Kashmir, and therefore terror was not as important as Kashmir. I'll just play the clip. I want you to listen to it. It's a 1 minute clip.
First of all, Karan, you know, it is important that whether it is, you know, UN resolutions or Shimla Agreement or the 1999 Lahore Declaration, we need to understand that from our perspective, and I think India also recognizes that, that Jammu and Kashmir is the mother of all our issues, bilateral issues.
Well, India would say that terror is perhaps that.
Let me. And then, you know, and the other issues like Siachen, Sar Creek, water issues, terrorism, they all have their roots in the Jammu and Kashmir dispute. So I think at the end of the day, it would be absolutely important for our two countries to work with the sincerity of purpose to overcome our differences on Jammu and Kashmir and try to settle it.
You've gone back, High Commissioner, to a formulation that we hadn't heard from a Pakistani official for a while. Your answer clearly suggests that Jammu and Kashmir is the core issue. Terrorism, in your eyes, is a subset of it. It's not even equivalent.
All our issues, you know, have their origin or genesis in the Jammu and Kashmir.
So Pakistan's gone back to the position
that we have not gone back.
J&K is the core issue.
We have not gone back, but it is a reality. And I think our Indian friends also understand that.
Mr. Hussain, you would have heard there is a gulf of difference between what Ambassador Basit said on the 7th of May and how the Ufa statement treats Kashmir last Friday. Is this a reversal or at least a significant shift in Pakistan's position rather than just a lapse and mistake? Because the difference is huge.
I would say, I think the Ufa statement is fine, but the important thing was that Mr. Modi and Mr. Sharif met, and there was no dialogue, there was no communication. And they had to come out with a piece of paper which is known as the joint statement. And that was put together by the diplomats. But I think there's no two ways about that, what Basit said. And he's right about that, because Kashmir is the core issue. It's like saying when you discuss the Middle East that the main issue is terrorism. It's not terrorism, it's Palestine.
So you're saying to me that what High Commissioner Basit said is the correct Pakistani position on Kashmir. It is the core issue. It is, as the High Commissioner said, the mother of all issues. Everything else, including terror, is subordinate to it. That is the correct Pakistani viewpoint. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, I think that is the representative viewpoint of the people, of the establishment, of the parliament, and of the state of Pakistan.
In which case,
there's no two ways about that.
In which case, Mr. Hussain, how do you account for the fact that on Saturday after his return from Ufa, Sartaj Aziz said to Dawn newspaper, and that's one of your papers, that Kashmir would be discussed, and I'm quoting, under the back channel track 2 mechanism. Now, the back channel, as you know, is something that can be disowned. In fact, Zardari disowned the Musharraf back channel when he came to power. Kayani didn't accept the outcome either. And track 2 is not even official. So what Sartaj Aziz said to Dawn is even worse than the absence of Kashmir from the Ufa statement. Because Sartaj Aziz, by saying it will be discussed on the back channel or track 2, is either diminishing focus on Kashmir or actually demoting the importance of Kashmir.
No, I don't think. My interpretation is different, Mr. Thapa. Because India is not willing to discuss Kashmir at the level of foreign secretaries, and the previous Indian position was that Kashmir is a settled issue. The only issue left is that it's the Pakistani part of Kashmir. But now, agreeing to discuss Kashmir, like his predecessor, Mr. Vajpayee, through the back channel, Mr. Modi has accepted that the Kashmir issue is a disputed issue, and which we have always maintained, it requires discussion, and it requires discussion all outside the glare of publicity and or the media. So the back channel would be an important track to take it forward. So it's good. India has recognized the disputed nature of Kashmir, which requires intense discussion in a very quiet sort of way.
You know, you're saying,
as long as Kashmir is on the table and we are moving forward, that's fine.
You're laying stress on the fact that India has agreed to discuss Kashmir. The truth is India has always been willing to discuss Kashmir. The point I'm making is the level at which that discussion will happen. Let me point this out to you. From Pakistan's point of view, Kashmir is the core issue. From India's point of view, terror is the core issue. After Ufa, terror will be discussed by national security advisors. It's been elevated above the foreign secretary level. After Ufa, Kashmir, your key concern, will not be discussed any longer by foreign secretaries. It's coming down to the back channel, which, as I said, can be disowned, or even track two, which is not even official. Hereafter, the two key core issues of either side are not being treated by the same level of importance. Terror has been elevated to NSAs. Kashmir has been demoted.
If you remember in 1997, when there was agreement on the composite dialogue, there was a list of six or seven issues, including Kashmir, including Siachen, including Sir Creek, including trade, including terrorism and violence. So all of those are being discussed concurrently. So as long as Kashmir is on the table, it is being discussed at whatever level, whether overtly or covertly. The issue is alive, it is on the agenda. And okay, the Indians might say it's not on the top of the priority list. We say it's number one on the priority list. But as long as it's on the table, both sides will have to discuss it, whether it's the military or the political side or the back channel side.
My quick point here, you don't think that the optics of the level at which the discussion on Kashmir will happen matter? You were very conscious in pointing out that the optics on not mentioning Kashmir and Ufa was a mistake and a lapse. What about the optics of the level at which the Kashmir discussion will happen? It's not happening any longer at the foreign secretary level. It's been demoted to either back channel or track two, whereas terror has been promoted above foreign secretaries to NSA. You don't think that optic matters?
No, I think that if the foreign secretary level talks are not even proceeding, so the national security advisor is slightly higher than the foreign secretary level. And whether you call it terrorism or whether you call it something else, Pakistan will definitely put Kashmir on the top of the agenda. In any case, Mr. Thapar, the ground situation in Indian occupied Kashmir is such also that the Indian government would be forced to discuss it, because the people of Indian occupied Kashmir have rejected the Indian occupation and they are resisting that Indian occupation. So we didn't start the insurgency, we can't stop the insurgency. We only give them moral and diplomatic and political support, which we will continue to give at the bilateral level and the international level.
All right, Senator Hussain, let's come to the second key issue covered by Ufa, and that is the agreement to discuss ways and means to expedite the Mumbai case trial, including additional information like providing voice samples. Now, first of all, what does providing voice samples mean? Does it mean that Pakistan will provide a voice sample of Lakhvi's voice, so that the intercepts can be matched against that voice sample? Or does it mean, as your information minister Pervez Rashid and then again today Sartaj Aziz have said, that this means India will provide better evidence to help convict? Which of the two is it?
Well, I think that from our side we have been very clear that we would like to proceed further, but for want of evidence, and India unwilling to give that, share that evidence, which should have been done long time ago, because India has been using this case to play to the international gallery and to do Pakistan bashing. So it's mostly a PR exercise rather than a serious effort to really bring the culprits to book. So we are, when we talk of additional information, it means that there has to be a flow of evidence, flow of information from the Indian side to the Pakistani side, so that we can go along with the prosecution.
This is, from the Indian point of view, a very important question, which is why I'm going to ask you to be very clear and specific. The Indian government believes that UFA has committed Pakistan to providing Lakhvi's voice sample so that his voice can be matched against the intercepts that you already have. The failure to match the voice against those intercepts means those intercepts have not been treated as evidence by the trial court. Now, are you saying to me today that this reading of UFA is wrong, that Pakistan will not provide those voice samples of Lakhvi?
Well, regarding the specifics and the technicalities of the case, I think the courts and the lawyers will decide that. But our interpretation is that there was mention of discussion, and which is not tantamount to any sort of commitment. So there's a difference in that. And that is a two-way street, and the flow of information from India would determine the pace and the sequence of what happens afterwards.
Can I interrupt? You're saying our interpretation is that this was a discussion and there is no commitment. Now, that's particularly worrying to Indian ears. Are you saying that that joint statement issued by the two prime ministers does not commit Pakistan to its contents?
No, it commits Pakistan and India to a bilateral process. Because, you see, India itself has been very confused on this count. All of a sudden, they internationalized this issue and went to the United Nations, where they were blocked by China. So they were on the back foot, and they've come back again to Pakistan. So we hope that now that they have decided to discuss it bilaterally with us, they will at least give us what they have said also in the joint statement, which was signed by both sides, additional information. Okay. So we await the response from the Indian side.
Of course, the joint statement, and I'm quoting the joint statement, says, including additional information like providing voice samples. Voice samples can only be provided by Pakistan. The intercepts are already with you. The voice sample can only be Lakhvi's. This is why I keep coming back to it. Are you now ruling out providing Lakhvi's voice sample? Or are you saying simply at this point of time you don't know whether it will be provided or not? Which of the two are you saying? Ruling it out or saying you don't
nothing
know?
Nothing is being ruled in or ruled out. It all depends on the sequence of events. All we are hoping for is that the additional information, whether it's evidence or what they collected in the Kasab trial, which India has not shared with Pakistan so far, India will share with Pakistan rather than playing to the gallery, rather than using it for propaganda or PR purposes. And then that sequence will have a bilateral process on both sides.
Now, that's very interesting. You very clearly and categorically said nothing is being ruled out, nothing is being ruled in. So the possibility of Pakistan providing Lakhvi's voice samples remains. It exists. It hasn't been ruled out. The problem is this. 24 hours after the UFA statement, the chief of your prosecution team, Chaudhry Azhar, told the press in Lahore that the Pakistan government will not file a fresh petition in the trial court for obtaining Lakhvi's voice sample. In response to that, your High Commissioner in India last night said to the Indian press, don't jump to premature conclusions. Now, of the two men, who should we believe? Should we go by the head of your prosecution team saying that they won't apply for voice samples? Or should we go by your High Commissioner who says don't jump to premature conclusions? Because the two men are saying what looks like opposite things.
There are legal processes in both countries. There is the rule of law. And as you know, Mr. Thapar, we have a very fiercely independent judiciary these days. So the lawyers will do what they have to do according to the rule of law. And that process will take its own due course. And I don't want to speak on behalf of the lawyers because I'm not a lawyer. Those are technical issues and they will take their course. But once the political decision has been taken at the highest level, we hope that, as I mentioned before, the Indian side will share the evidence, the information, the data they have, which they have withheld from Pakistan in the past.
Absolutely.
And that will allow us to proceed
forward. If there is any data that has been withheld from Pakistan, although the Indian government strongly and strenuously disputes that, of course it must be shared. But equally, if both sides are going to honor UFA, the Indian side hopes that Pakistan will provide Lakhvi's voice sample, which is clearly what you've committed to do. Are you giving me and through me, the Indian people, some assurance that that commitment will also be kept?
There was a commitment in UFA by both sides to discuss this issue and various dimensions of the issue, including provision of additional information.
And voice samples. Please don't miss out that phrase. And voice samples.
Yeah, no, I've read the statement several times. But I'm just saying that let's be very clear that it takes two to tango. So if the Indian side, there has to be reciprocity. And from the Indian side, we are expecting a more serious and a more mature response rather than trying to put Pakistan in the dock and play to the international gallery as they have been playing in the past. That's why they went to the United Nations and they failed. So they came back to Pakistan for that.
I want to come back to one last question. I'll move away from specifics and details. I want to come back to the overall impression that the UFA joint statement has created. Whether it's the focus on terror, whether it's the absence of any specific mention of Kashmir, which you generously accepted a moment ago was a lapse, or whether it's the commitment to give voice samples, which now perhaps Pakistan is trying to wriggle out of, the clear impression in India is that the UFA statement caters for all India's concerns in a fairly substantial way, whilst not catering in the same substantial way to Pakistan's concerns. And you, in a sense, conceded it when you said Kashmir should have been mentioned by name. Many people in your country believe that perhaps Pakistan signed on under some form of pressure from America, pressure from China. How do you respond to that view?
No, not at all. I think it's, as I mentioned before, it is Mr. Modi who, after taking a very hard line, both in terms of rhetoric and also on the ground, he had to move back. He did a U-turn and he called Mr. Sharif for Ramadan. And then he sought a meeting, requested a meeting at UFA. We didn't do that. The initiative came from the Indian side. And then he was forced to do that, that given the regional situation and the pressure on India, because India's tactics in the last 1 year to bully browbeat Pakistan, to isolate Pakistan failed, because we right now have excellent relations with China, with Russia, with the USA, and all these countries feel that the road to Afghan peace lies through Pakistan. So they need Pakistan for the regional peace, security, and stability. And India felt sidelined.
Can I interrupt? As an independent journalist who speaks only for the profession of journalism and not for either India or Pakistan, I can accept your point that there looks like an apparent change of position in the Modi government agreeing to meet the Pakistan Prime Minister after Mrs. Swaraj just recently in June said no talks with Pakistan are possible until Lakhvi is brought to justice. You're right. It does look as if in agreeing to meet Mr. Nawaz Sharif, India did a U-turn. But what's equally apparent, and perhaps much more importantly so, is that the outcome at UFA, and I'm going by the statement, the outcome at UFA suggests that India's concerns have been met very substantially. Pakistan's concern, Kashmir, hasn't even been mentioned by name. And therefore, I put it to you again. This looks like an agreement where Pakistan has made concessions to India, even though India made a concession in agreeing to meet in the first place.
It was a joint statement, not an agreement. And it's very clear when we talk of terrorism, we feel that India is involved in cross-border terrorism, destabilizing Pakistan, violating the United Nations Charter, violating the SAARC Convention on Terrorism. So we have our own concerns, so we welcome the discussion on terrorism.
Which you make so much of has not been mentioned in the statement. If they were to be mentioned, it would have given a different outcome and a different impression.
Mr. Sartaj says that it was discussed at different meeting with Mr.
That's
Modi.
That's the point. It may have been discussed. It's not in the statement.
When we talk of terrorism, we are very clear what we are talking about. And it is cross-border terrorism, which India has initiated against Pakistan.
But Kashmir is subsumed under the phrase all outstanding issues. Your key concern, the mother of all concerns, as your High Commissioner puts it, is covered under the phrase all outstanding issues. That's very much a secondary position.
Not at all. As I said, can you have Hamlet without the Prince of Denmark? That is the core issue. We are not going to discuss the weather.
What UFA produced is a play without Hamlet. You've got the ghost there, that's all. The actual character is missing.
Then in that case, it'll go nowhere. Then it'll become just another joint statement. It'll just become semantics without substance. We don't want that.
All right.
We want the process to move forward. We feel finally Mr. Modi has come around, because the trend in the region has to be more inclusive. less divisive and talking of regional harmony and cooperation. And India should stop this crying, cribbing and whining around, always complaining about Pakistan everywhere. So it should let's talk as mature, a sovereign, equal states in South Asia to build a better tomorrow.
All right, Senator Hussain, let's leave it there. My thanks to you for agreeing to speak to us. It's a pleasure to have you on the program.